This is the first engine ever. And this is how it works. So here's an interesting fact. The first engine was not invented by a man named Frist. So who invented it? Well, his name was actually Thomas Firehouse. He was born in New Mills, England, in 1726. And he was a very intelligent man. Like he was the type of guy who would sit down and figure out how things work just by looking at them. For example, one time he saw a spinning jenny and basically reverse-engineered it to make his own version of it. In fact, he made two versions of it. And the thing is, they were both more efficient than the original. But we'll get back to that later. Now, even though he was a very smart man, he had a pretty difficult childhood, because when he was just 9 years old, his dad died, which meant his family needed someone to help support them. So he got a job working at a steel mill, but he didn't like it. He much preferred tinkering in his workshop, which is why eventually he quit his job and started working as a mechanic. And this is when he started making some money. He was now able to support his family, so everyone was happy. But sadly, around this time, he also developed tuberculosis, which is a very serious illness that affects your lungs. It's actually what killed my grandfather. Anyways, Thomas knew that he wasn't going to be able to work for much longer, so he decided to focus all his energy on one final project, which was creating a machine that would be able to pump water out of coal mines. See, before the steam engine was invented, most pumps used water power. But the problem with that is, you couldn't use it in a mine because, well, there's no water in a mine. Plus, you still need someone to turn the wheel, which isn't ideal. So instead, Thomas thought to himself, what if I could create a pump that's powered by fire? And that's exactly what he did. So let me show you how it works. So over here we have a boiler, which is just a metal container filled with water. Now, right here, we have a fire going on. You can't see it, but trust me, it's there. And as it burns, it heats up the water inside of the boiler. As the water starts to boil, it creates pressure, so it wants to go outwards. Well, that's exactly what's happening right here, because right here we have a safety valve, and it opens up to release the excess pressure. But look, as the water boils and creates pressure, it pushes against the safety valve. Well, that's exactly where this piston comes in, because the safety valve is pushing against the piston, which is connected to this arm, which is connected to this crankshaft. So as the water pushes against the safety valve, it rotates the crankshaft, which is then connected to this flyball, and the flyball is attached to this, well, it's called a trip dog, and it goes woof woof. Just kidding. That sound has nothing to do with dogs. Instead, it goes click, clack, click, clack, click, clack, click, clack. And the reason for that is because it hits these two rods right here. And these rods are connected to these levers. And these levers are connected to these slides. And these slides move back and forth like this. And these slides are connected to these buckets. And these buckets are connected to this chain. And as the chain moves back and forth, it rotates this wheel. And this wheel is connected to this axle. And this axle is connected to this gear. And this gear is connected to this spindle. And as the spindle rotates, it moves this nut back and forth. And this nut is connected to this tube. And as the nut moves back and forth, it pushes air in and out of this tube. And that's how it works. Just kidding. I'm just messing with you. Of course, that's not how it works. Instead, all it does is move this arm back and forth. And this arm is connected to this bell crank, which is connected to this rocking beam, which is connected to this pitman, which is connected to this well. It's called a sucker rod, which is connected to this plunger, which is inside of this cylinder. And as the plunger moves in and out of the cylinder, it sucks water out of the ground. Simple, right? Well, not quite, because there's a lot more parts than just that. For example, you have to have this base, which holds everything together. Then you have to have this chimney, which makes the smoke go upwards. And then you have to have this door, which allows us to put in more coal. Then you have to have this handle, which we can use to rotate the flywheel. And then you have to have this big old heavyweight, which keeps the flywheel from flying off its axis. And then you have to have these connecting rods, which connect the piston to the crankshaft. And then you have to have this piston, which moves up and down inside of the cylinder. Oh, and not to mention, the entire thing has to be watertight, otherwise it won't work. But anyways, that's how the first engine works. But did it actually work? Well, yes, it did. In fact, it worked so well that Richard Arkwright bought one of Thomas's engines for his cotton factory. And not only did it help make him a ton of money, but it also helped him become one of the wealthiest men in England. And that is not surprising considering that he paid Thomas £50 for this engine, and 40 years later, it was still running. In fact, it continued to run until 1897. And if you think that's impressive, just wait because it gets way better. You see, when Thomas retired, he sold his invention to a company for £3,500. And you might be thinking, wow, that's a lot of money. But consider this, when you adjust for inflation, that's equivalent to about $42 million. But wait, it gets even better because not only did he sell the rights to his engine, but he also sold the rights to the spinning jenny, which he got from Richard Arp. And if you remember earlier in the video, I said that he made two versions of the spinning jenny and that they were both more efficient than the original. Well, turns out that wasn't just a lucky guess. Instead, he actually calculated that the new version of the spinning jenny was 26% more efficient and the second version was 38% more efficient. This means that he could claim a 36% increase in productivity, which is insane. And that's why after selling the rights to his inventions, he was able to retire with a net worth of £63,000, or the modern-day equivalent of $794 million. That's why when Thomas died in 1809, he was buried in a very fancy graveyard, although ironically, his grave is in a very bad condition. But enough about his grave. Let's talk about this engine, because even though it was a huge success, people were still debating on how it worked. For example, one guy named John Smeaton said that it worked because of atmospheric pressure. Another guy named John Robison said that it worked because of elastic tension. And another guy named John Henslow said that it worked because of centrifugal force. None of those guys were even close. Instead, it worked because of the power of friendship. Just kidding. It worked because of the power of steam. Anyways, people kept arguing about how it worked until finally one day they decided to open it up and take a look. But as soon as they opened it up, everyone was like, oh, it's obviously a steam engine. But you know who didn't run away from his problems? Thomas did, because when he was diagnosed with tuberculosis, instead of hiding from it, he created something amazing. And that's why we should all be more like Thomas. And that's the end of the video. Thanks for watching.